Are you concerned with security? Now, I'm not talking about this guy following you around, but that'd be pretty cool. No, I'm talking about data security in your enterprise environment. If you answered no, you really should be, because data breaches are becoming more and more prevalent every day. Now, in this video, I'm going to show you how to deploy Workspace One Access, which is your identity and access management solution, which falls into the zero trust pillar of user access. It could, down the track, if you wanted to add device enrollment, all that sort of stuff, we can do that, but we won't cover that in this video. And the reason I want to show you how to do this successfully, and keyword there is successfully, is because there have been various reports, or I've seen reports of people having different issues with the deployment. Now, I can tell you straight up, three things will definitely make a fail. Connectivity, and by that I mean we want to make sure MTU is properly configured. Remember, it's being deployed onto an NSX segment. Especially if you're using overlay, it doesn't support fragmentation, so you need to make sure jumbo frames or MTU is correctly configured throughout your NSX real estate. Two, firewall ports could be blocking the deployment, so make sure all the appropriate ports are open. So I'll put a link to that in the description below. And three, DNS. I've said this time and time again, make sure DNS is properly configured and you've got the right records created for all this stuff. Now, let's get to it instead of just talking about it. Let's navigate to the Lifecycle Manager that we deployed in the previous video and log into it. Now, the login when it deployed through VCF is VCF admin at local and whatever password you assigned it. There's a lot that we can achieve with Lifecycle Manager. We're going to focus on a few things: getting binaries, deploying binaries, and basic password management. So the first thing we need to do is add a password or passwords so we can deploy the environment. To do so, we go into Locker, click on Passwords, then Add, and enter all the details. The first account you're going to need is the account that's got access to download binaries from VMware. The second one is the default password that's going to be used to deploy the first environment. Now, I've shown you how to do the first one. I won't repeat it for the second one. Now that we've set up the account, we can download the binaries or Workspace One Access. To do so, we go back to the main page, we click on Lifecycle Operations, click on Settings, select My VMware, add My VMware account, and pick the account that we just created. Click Validate and then Add. Once that's all good, we can proceed. All right, let's head back to Settings, then Binary Mapping, Add Binaries. We're going to select My VMware and then hit Discover. You can see a list of binaries have been discovered. We need to make sure we get the install bundle for Identity Manager, which is the second one. The upgrade won't work because we're not actually upgrading an environment. Once you click Add, the download will start. It's called a request in Lifecycle Manager. Essentially, anything you do in Lifecycle Manager is a request and it goes and processes the requests. If you click on requests or the click here, you can see the request in progress. If we select it, it will show you the stages it's at. Depending on your internet connection, this can take a bit of time, so we'll just let that complete. The binary has downloaded, which means we can move on to the next step of deployment. Click on Create Environment. There's a few options in this screen. The first one is if you want to install Identity Manager, which we do want to, so I'll select that one. You'll notice when you do that, you'll get Global Environment as the environment name, which is not changeable, that's fine. Next, we've got the password for the environment. We created one earlier, as I showed you. I'm just selecting that now. Then you've got the data center name. I've only got one, but if you've got multiple, select the one where you want to deploy to. Then you've got the JSON configuration. If you're going to use a JSON, select this. If not, just click Next. This is the screen where you select the product to deploy. Now, we're only seeing Identity Manager here because it's the only one we've downloaded so far. The more products you download, the more you'll see here. First, check the box to indicate you want to deploy Identity Manager. Then you've got two installation types, new install and import. New install is straightforward. Import is if you've got an existing environment and you want Lifecycle Manager to import it. Then you've got the version and deployment type. The deployment type is standard and clustered, and we'll go through that now.
I wanted to really iron out the differences between a standard deployment and a clustered deployment. The obvious point is a standard deployment is a single appliance and a cluster deployment is three appliances. That's okay, that's fairly standard stuff. But the real difference is with the standard deployment, it doesn't need a VIP, it doesn't need a load balancer because it's a single appliance and LCM has no interaction with NSX. When you do the cluster deployment, it deploys the three nodes, it creates a VIP, It creates the server profiles in NSX for load balancing. It creates the server pools as well as the virtual servers. So all of this stuff is done for you and you don't have to do it yourself. That's really neat to know because it can take a bit of time if you don't know anything about networking, if you're new to load balancing, all that sort of stuff can be time consuming. So let's get to it and I'll show you exactly what I'm talking about.
As we just discussed, I'm going to deploy the cluster approach so I can show you everything that goes on when you do so. Click next once you're done. The EULA is very fascinating. If you want to read it, go for it. But I'm just going to scroll to the bottom, hit accept and go next and we can move on. Certificates are very important when deploying products in Lifecycle Manager. You've got the choice of generating them locally or importing ones you've got signed from a CA. In this case, we're going to use the local generated certificates and I'll show you how to do that now. But you can see here, I've already done a few. That's okay. I'm just going to hit the plus there, click on generate. Ensure you add all the FQDNs and all the IP addresses for the VIPs as well as the servers. It's very important you do so. Click generate once you finish populating this. As you saw, I've already done one, so I won't recreate it. I'll select my certificate and you can see that I've got under the subject alternate names, all the IP addresses, including the VIP, as well as all the servers, as well as the FQDN of the VIP. Click next once you're done. There are some additional infrastructure details you need to populate here. Some you can't touch. For example, the network you can't touch, but you can pick the cluster you want to deploy to, resource pool if you want to change it. Disk type, I'm going to keep it as thin and we're not using a content library in this example. If you are, then go for it. Click next once you're done. This page should also be for the most part pre-populated, but if you want to add additional DNS servers, you can. I'm not going to in this case, I'm just going to click next and move on. There's a few details on this page. First, we've got the certificate at the top, which I won't repeat. We've already seen that. You've got the node size. I'm going to select small, but make sure you size it appropriately for your environment. We've got the lab password, which has been pre-selected anyways. The default configuration, admin, email, and username. I've made this up, but you can name it whatever you want for your environment. So config admin in this case, there's nothing magical there. Then you've got the sync group members, which I'll leave unchecked. We've got the cluster VIP FQDN, which is wsashank.com, and it resolves, so make sure you've got a DNS record for that, and it's in your certificate as well. The certificate, be careful here, this is not the IP address that resolves to the FQDN of the VIP. It's an internal proxy for the Postgres database that you need to assign an IP that's not already allocated. I will select it as the VIP for now to show you how it errors out. The rest of it is just each appliance, the FQDN and the IP address assigned to it in DNS. All of that is populated and then we'll move on and do the pre-check. Click next once you're ready. Time to click the blue button that says pre-check, let it run through. Make sure all of this is good, otherwise the most basic checks will fail. Time to check the little box and then click on run pre-check and the tests will begin. We've hit our first error. Let's have a look what it's telling us in infrastructure validations. It's telling me that the IP address does not resolve to the node that we had selected, so WSA01. Let's see why. I'll do a quick ping check firstly, or a resolving check to make sure that it is correct. A simple ping should do the trick here. We see WSA01.shank.com resolves to something, an IP address, but notice the IP address. It's not right. So let's go back to networks, scroll down. Okay, see what's happened here? I've really poorly copied and pasted incorrectly. So the same FQDN was used twice for 02 and 01. So let me fix up WSA02 and we'll rerun the pre-check. Okay, rerun, tick the box, run pre-check. Here we go again. All right, we've hit another error. Hopefully this is the one I wanted to show you. There you go. So the IP and the load balancer is causing us an issue, especially with the IP we've assigned. If I click on view under recommendations, it'll give us a bit more information. There's a bit more of an explanation. I've already explained to you what the issue was. This may not be easy to get sometimes, but at least you know what that means and how to fix it. So let's jump back. I'll set the IP differently, not to .9, which is the VIP. I'll set it to .8, which is just an unused IP address. We'll hit next, run the pre-check, and it should all validate now. And that's what we want to see. We're good to go. Hit next and we can start the deployment. It's a bit of a summary page before you can. The export config makes it easy to download a JSON. If next time you want to redeploy, you can just upload the JSON and all of this is ready to go. So cool, we're gonna hit submit now and let that kick off.
Now you can see there's a lot of stages here. It goes from 1 through to 27. It's going to take quite a bit of time. I'm going to say about an hour. We'll come back and check on it in a bit. There you have it, every stage completed. You can see at the top, successful, and it's been going for about an hour and 15 minutes. Cool, let's check vCenter to see the appliances deployed. There are three WSA appliances, 01, 02, and 03. There's also some NSX config, so networking, load balancing. There you can see the virtual server, the load balancer has two virtual servers on the right-hand side. HTTP and HTTPS protocols for WSA. We got a virtual servers, the same things that we just saw, port 80 and 443. Then we've got the server pool. The members would consist of the three nodes that we deployed. That's okay, that's good. Then the same virtual server is also attached. Cool, that all looks good. And that means we've got load balancing configured. We've got profiles that have been assigned to the load balancer and monitors also created as part of the workflow. So all of this stuff has been time saved for you.
Hopefully by now you've got the ins and outs of deploying Workspace ONE Access and the gotchas. I even threw in an issue there on purpose. But if you've forgotten or missed a couple of steps on how to get to this point, you do need a Lifecycle Manager, so watch this video to be able to see how to deploy it. And as a precursor to that, you do need edge nodes and AVMs. So those two videos will sort you out there. I'll catch you in the next video.